Hello, our thanks go to the organisers for this opportunity to talk to you today about our project following the work of a master builder in carving a Ngalawa logboat in Bagamoyo, Tanzania. My name is Dr. John P. Cooper of the University of Exeter Centre for Islamic Archaeology, and I'm standing in today for our lead author, Dr. Elgidius Ichumbaki of the University of Dar es Salaam's Department of Archaeology and Heritage, who unfortunately has recently been indisposed. Our other authors are Mr. Philip Maligisu, Ms. Sinyati Mark, Dr. Thomas Biginagwa, all of the University of Dar es Salaam, and also Dr. Lucy Blue of the University of Southampton. Okay, so in the presentation today, what we would like to do is briefly introduce to you our wider project within which this building process took place. Also to introduce to you the Ngalawa logboat as being a very important boat of the East African region among fishing communities. Touch upon ethnographic observation and its role in understanding boat building as a craft. And then hopefully we'll spend most of the time on the carving process itself, following this entire sequence from the tree that you can see on the left here to the final boat in the water, which we'll go on to see. And then hopefully within that, we'll be able to draw some conclusions about what we've learned from the entire process. So let's go. The Ngalawa was built for and named after the Bahari Yetu Urithi Wetu project, in English, Our Ocean, Our Heritage. The project is a collaboration between the University of Dar es Salaam, the University of Exeter, and the University of Southampton. It was funded as part of the Rising from the Depths Network, an initiative of the UK Government's Global Challenges Research Fund. The project centres on the historic town of Bagamoyo, Tanzania, which today is an important centre for fishing, trade with Zanzibar across the Zanzibar Channel, and to a lesser extent, tourism. It aimed to understand and document the maritime heritage of Bagamoyo and to seek ways of leveraging that heritage for the public good. The Ngalawa build was commissioned in order for us to document the construction process, but one public-facing outcome has been the making of a documentary film of the process, which has already had its premiere in Dar es Salaam and will appear alongside our academic article on the build, which is currently under review. So what is the Ngalawa? In terms of technicalities, it is an extended logboat, that is a logboat with additional timbers that raise the sides to make it more seaworthy. It also has a double outrigger, which are the floats that you can see on either side, which are there for stability. It also has a lateen, i.e. a triangular sailed rig, with occasionally, as in this photograph, an outboard motor, but that's really not very common. It's also the most common fishing vessel of the Swahili coast, being relatively low cost, speedy, and able to operate in the shallows as well as to be beached. And it also has the stability at the same time to work in relatively deep waters for a dugout because of the stability that those outriggers provide. It's a vessel that has been studied very little of late for various reasons. However, it was quite widely discussed during the colonial era by European scholars, largely, I would say, due to its remarkable and, dare we say, exotic appearance. Discussion at that time was often tainted by racist and diffusionist narratives that attributed the origin of the vessel without evidence to non-African sources in Southeast Asia. Our Ngalawa build was arguably not an experimental archaeological project at all. We were not, after all, seeking to replicate through processes of trial and error in craft the material patterns found on archaeological remains or iconographic evidence. However, part of what we were doing was to approach the same problems of how to interpret craft through archaeological remains. To put our hands up, we did not have the archaeological remains, but we did have something that is rarely found in many parts of the world today, particularly the richer parts, and that is a living craft tradition that produces a type of vessel that does occur often enough in the archaeological record around the world, and that is the logboat. In other words, we were gathering data on practice that might in future inform experimental practices related to the carving of logboats found in archaeological contexts. Our secret weapon in all of this was the very gifted Mr. Alalae Mohamed, a talented carver of logboats in his late 50s who is a walking challenge to our notion of tradition and apprenticeship. He is exclusively a carver of logboats, not a builder of plank boats, and he is expert in carving three types, the Ngalawa that we are discussing today, as well as the Umtumwi and the Mashur Ndogo. One of the many remarkable things about him is that he is entirely self-taught. He is the son of a single mother who had no formal training or apprenticeship at all. What he knows, he learned through observation and attempts at replication. In other words, he has a lot in common with experimental archaeologists. It was Mr. Alalae who built our Ngalawa and who talked us through the process. So let's now look at the process. First, of course, one must find one's tree, or in the case of a Ngalawa, two trees. The main dugout, its side extension planks, and the floats for the outrigger these days most commonly come from the mango tree. A large timber for the prow, which sits almost entirely above the waterline, is usually made from the lighter and less dense wood of the cashew tree. In theory, other trees are preferable over mango. Mr. Alalae identified them for us. But these are tightly controlled by Tanzania's forestry authorities. Moreover, one simply cannot cut down a tree. It must be bought from its owner. Permission must be taken from the local village community. And on the way, en route, the shipment is checked by officials to verify that permission has been granted. The work took place on three sites. Reduction of the mango tree to the basic hull shape and the sawing of planks that would become the extension planks and outrigger floats took place at the felling site to make the log more transportable. Likewise, the prow timber at the site of the cashew tree. The components were then transported by lorry to the town of Bagamoyo and the process finished off there. This was similar to, but different from, Mr. Alalae's normal process. He would normally transport the reduced timbers home by handcart, but the project budget allowed for a lorry in this case. Mr. Alalae did the finer shaping in the town centre outside a prominent heritage building in order to meet the public outreach objectives of the project. Mr. Alalae used a range of tools, largely axes and adzes, to reduce the timbers. For the preliminary shaping, he called in a chainsaw operator. But he did the initial marking out and was very much in control of what would be cut and where, and was constantly giving directions during this period and checking by eye. Preliminary reduction of even the inner hull was at first done with the chainsaw, A, and felling axe, B, and later using a combination of felling axe to make deep incisions and foot adz, D, to remove material thus exposed. Vertical faces were often later reduced using a hand axe, C, that had an offset handle to protect the hands. Meanwhile, a dedicated hand adz with narrow blade, F, was used to reduce the narrow interior of the hull at the bow and stern. Mr. Alalae used a ship slice, G, to give the interior of the hull a smooth finish. When attaching the extension planks, he used a panel saw, J, to form the butt joints, and a pruning saw, I, to cut along the line of the seam to achieve a close joint. He used a bow drill, K, to make the holes for the nails that would fit the extension planks. Generally speaking, boat builders and boat carvers do not have access to power tools. Accommodation notches, meanwhile, for the nail heads were made with a flat chisel. What was remarkable to see in Mr. Alalae's work was his ability to conceive of and affect three-dimensional shape, born in part out of decades of experience and in part, no doubt, by his innate ability. He did use inked string, pulled taut and flicked, to mark out center lines and cut lines, for example in A here, as well as twigs in C here, to check his offsets. But he did a lot by eye alone, for example when he marked out the crucial shear line in the bark of the log with a hand axe for the chainsaw operator to follow. And here in B, when using a reed to mark out the rake of the stern. He also used a forked pen, D, called the kalamu, to transfer the line of the upper edge of the dugout to the lower edges of the extension planks in order to ensure a tight fit between the two. We clearly do not have time to go through every stage of the build, so here we present some techniques that might be of interest in the context of experimental archaeology. First, we have the rough establishment of the exterior hull shape, in this case with a chainsaw. Next, we have the rough, though quite conservative, removal of material from the top of the log as the process of hollowing begins. This involved multiple deep incisions with a chainsaw and the removal of material in between with a felling axe. The chainsaw was set aside once finer work was required to start, and here reduction alternated between felling axes for vertical incisions and adzes for horizontal ones. Once the interior was broadly shaped, the vessel was tipped slightly and the sides worked upon. Thick material was removed by making vertical incisions with an axe, then removing the material in between the incisions. The log was then turned upside down and a flat and narrow face on the bottom established with an adze. As greater precision became necessary, the felling axe was set aside to be replaced with the adze, hand axe with offset handle, and ultimately on the inside with a ship's slice. Once the essential shape of the dugout section is established, the broad sequence of the assembly process is as follows. First, the vessel's characteristic prow timber is shaped and fitted temporarily to the vessel at the bow. Then the extension planks are fitted, raising the sides of the vessel and establishing the ultimate shear line. These planks are from a different part of the same mango trunk. The outrigger floats and rudder are also shaped from the same mango timbers, as are the thwarts and any required patches. Small beams are set inside the vessel to provide rigidity and also anchoring points for the outrigger beams later. Finally, the hull is adzed smooth to a quite exquisite finish. The added timbers of the hull, the prow timber and the extension planks, for example, are fixed to the dugout using handmade nails that are driven through pre-drilled holes, drilled with the bow drill, that is, and these holes pass through the timber and down into the dugout section, but the holes do not re-emerge and therefore the nails do not re-emerge. Mr. Alalae then gave each nail, before he drove it in, a curve so that the nail would bite inside the hole that had been made and would not come out again. Finally, the outrigger structure is created. It is lashed to the hull, these days using nylon ropes, and a lateen rig is fitted. The outrigger beams and mast are eucalyptus, the yard is bamboo, and the sail is of cotton. So here is a little clip of the Bahari Yetu Urithi Wetu under sail just off Bagamoyo, crewed by colleagues from the University of Dar es Salaam and skippered by Mr. Alalae. I hope it gives you a sense of the versatility, stability and speed of this wonderful little vessel. Our outcomes have been to document the knowledge and skills of a talented carver, Mr. Alalae Mohamed. Through outreach activities not discussed here, we have also celebrated and in some sense validated the skills of a marginalized community, and we have gone some way to redressing the astonishing absence of African craft practices from global nautical studies. Thank you for listening. We are grateful to our funder, the Rising from the Depths Network, for making this year-long project and this collaboration possible. We look forward to new opportunities for us all to work together again. We are grateful to the Tanzanian Commission for Science and Technology, the University of Dar es Salaam, Bagamoyo District Council, and the Tanzania Forest Service for their respective permits and clearances to do our research. We are, of course, deeply grateful to Mr. Alalae Mohamed and his assistants, Hamis Jecha, Hamis Mulile, David Nvugu, and Mr. Agostino for their work, skills, and friendship. We are also grateful to the wider Bagamoyo community and to the master's students of the University of Dar es Salaam who gave their time and enthusiasm in support of this project.